We're talking to Dr. Al Hadid, the former chairperson of the Africana Studies Department at Tennessee State University. And of course, the topic is Islam and the African-American experience. And Dr. Al Hadid is giving us some information in reference to Islam and the impact that this religion has had upon peoples all over the world. Of course, go on, Dr. Elodie, you can pick up at that point.
Yeah, we briefly talked about the fifth pillar, which was the pilgrimage to Mecca, and in terms of how the experience that Malcolm X had. Let's go right into Africa in terms of how Islam spread through Africa. The first thing is that there's a myth out here that Islam spread through Africa by the sword. That is not, in fact, the case. But I want to focus primarily on West Africa. In West Africa, there were some very powerful empires. In fact, there were three. One was the Mali Empire, the Ghana Empire, and the Songhai Empire. And so Islam went into Africa during the heydays and the heights of those latter two empires, the Mali Empire and the Songhai Empire. And then from there, it went into Spain. Where it established the Moorish Empire, which lasted from 711 to 1492, which is roughly the time that Columbus left Spain and went out to so-called discover, the New World. Islam in Africa did a number of things. In brief, it did much of the things that it did in Arabia. That is, it went to unite people across tribal differences. It established another alphabet by which the African culture could be written. I'm not suggesting that there were no alphabets in Africa. Certainly there were alphabets in West Africa, and of course we know about the hieroglyphics that were in Egypt. But it went in and it established libraries and connected Africa with the rest of the world through trade. One of the most lucrative trade was the trade in gold and salt. And so the technology that existed in the Muslim world was then imported into West Africa. Well, as these empires developed and they had various kings and technology, of course, around 1444, that's the point at which the Portuguese and the Spanish start going into Africa and engage in the transatlantic slave trade. Well, that trade developed in such a, vicious way, and that dispersed Africans throughout the so-called New World, in South America, in the Caribbean, in North America. In terms of the percentage of Muslims that were captured and brought over here, historians are not agreed on that actual percentage. I guess the low estimate would be about 20% of the captives from West Africa. When we say West Africa, we're talking primarily the area around Morocco, Guinea, Liberia, Sierra Leone, Nigeria, et cetera, and which what is called the Guinea Coast. So if we say about 20%, and some say as high as 40% to 50%, and the others who were not Muslims were practitioners of traditional African religion. When they brought them over here, one of the first things that they tried to do was to stamp out Islam from among them, because they knew that if they maintained this particular religion, then they would always be in a state of rebellion against the plantation and the system of enslavement. Proof of which is before they came over here, the Europeans were engaged in the Crusades and the Inquisitions, and it was very difficult fighting against them. And as I've said earlier, the Africans from North Africa went into Spain and occupied Spain for about 700 years. So they were very much aware of the militancy that they knew that Islam was a force to be reckoned with, because at that point, Europe was pretty much held at bay. And it wasn't brought out of this landlocked situation until after the end of the First World War with the fall of the Ottoman Empire. But getting back on this side of the Atlantic, so they said made sure that they stamped out, Islam. So in fact, they were fairly successful in doing this for a period of time. And then let's go forward to the latter part of the 19th century. At that point, Islam started to emerge again. And as we go into the 20th century, it came out in the form of the Moorish Science Temple with Noble Drew Ali around 1916. And of course, there was Marcus Garvey that we talked about earlier. Marcus Garvey had been taught by Dusse Muhammad, who was a Muslim from Egypt. And so even though he was not a Muslim per se, he more or less tried to bring his followers to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, but that Islamic influence was there because Dusse Muhammad was one of his mentors. So if you look at a combination of what he learned from Dusse Muhammad and also the presence of the Moorish science inside of America, so that started to develop. One thing about this particular approach to Islam, it differed quite significantly from Islam as it appeared in the Arabian Peninsula and also Islam as it was practiced in West Africa. And that difference, I think, came about because of the existence of racism and white supremacy. Okay. Mm-hmm. And as you know, the ideology or nationalistic theology of the Nation of Islam suggested that maybe the white man was the devil, and the black man was God. But that had nothing actually to do with true Islam. Mm-hmm. It, that wasn't the way it was taught in West Africa, where we came from, nor was that the way it was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, in Arabia. But be that as it may, that very strong nationalistic spirit started to develop in our community. And it wasn't until Malcolm made the pilgrimage in 1965 that things started to revert back to the universal and original conception of Islam. And that universal conception is existing in the African American community today. I think you can look at two directions that it went. One is that when Malcolm came back from Mecca, he started to bring about the universal ideas of Islam. And then when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad passed in 1975, his son, Imam Warraqi Muhammad, who just recently passed this month, as a matter of fact, he passed on the 9th, but he was very, very instrumental in converting most of the followers of his father to Sunni or mainstream Islam. And so that significantly increased the number of mainstream Muslims in America. Another thing that significantly increased the number of mainstream Muslims was the fact that immigration policies became more relaxed, and then you had more immigrant Muslims coming from Pakistan, from Egypt, and Syria. So today I would say that the vast majority of African-American Muslims practice true Islam the way it was revealed to our Prophet Muhammad, you know, in the 7th century. Yeah.
Okay, and of course, we're getting ready for the second commercial break.
Yes,
here,
I sense that.
You sense that, yeah.
Yes, sir.
And of course, you know, as normal, we hate to interrupt you,
but there's no problem.
Of course, you know, we have to take this break, and after which we'll have about 10 minutes to come back, and we'll be able to wrap this up. We'll be back with our audience following this very, very short commercial break. We're talking to Dr.